In today's khutbah, keeping in mind that it is the anniversary of the wafat of our 10th Imam, Imam Ali al-Naqi al-Hadi alayhi salatu wa salam. I'd like to share with you an incident in his life, but a preamble to that would be this issue of, you know, dealing with our challenges as human beings. Just a few nights ago, I was talking about the human condition. Islam doesn't ignore the nature of the human being. And whatever challenges that we face, Islam is very clear in providing the guidance for it. And one of the issues is this issue of desire, of different kinds that people have. During our own time, we see one of the manifestations of this on a global level is this desire for, you know, addiction to alcohol. Islam basically has talked about it, the harm of this, and made it forbidden from day one, from the early days. There were three or four ayat which came gradually until it was prohibited totally and absolutely. The modern science, of course, it took its own time. Only now we see during our time that, you know, the research is showing the harm of, you know, addiction to alcohol at different levels. Not only the issue of what it does to the health of the person, and the cost in taking care of the cancer and the other disease related to consumption of alcohol, but even on social level, when you talk about domestic violence, you know, the issue of divorce in many, many cases can be attributed back to this issue of addiction to alcohol, as well as the death of people, you know, on highways. And when we look at this issue, you know, Islam is very clear about it. And yet we see that the modern society is not really moving in that direction. The most we hear, don't drink and drive. And I say we change that slogan, not you know, don't drink at all. It's as simple as that. And this is where we see that, you know, even the World Health Organization has come up many times in the last 15 years that I have some of the cuttings from the reports where they say that, you know, there is no, this whole myth about moderate, you know, drinking is okay, this Mediterranean diet, that if you have a red wine, your heart would be healthy. They say these are all myths. You know, they are just doing this for their own commercial benefits. And they actually end up saying, it is better if you don't drink at all. This is what Islam had been saying 1400 years ago. And we see that this was a problem even in the Muslim society, of course. You know, even now, there are people who try to find the word haram for khamr in Quran. Even during the days of Abbasid, Khulafa of the early days, he actually asked the seventh Imam about it. And Imam said it is haram in the Quran. He said, but there's no ayat. And I don't want to go into details here. I want to go to another story here. But Imam explained to him that if you read these two ayats together, then you will see, you'll get the word haram from the Quran itself about khamr. You don't even have to go to the sunnah. But even now, you know, people try to find loopholes there. And it seems even the Khulafa, many of them were into it. Once during the days of the 10th Imam, Mutawakkil got some reports that, oh, this Imam Al-Hadi has been accumulating money and weapons for uprising against you. So he sent his officers to go and search. They went in, they found nothing, just simple household items. You know, his books and his musalla and the Quran. Yet they arrested him. It was night time. They took him to Mutawakkil. And when they took him to Mutawakkil, you know, Imam saw that he was busy drinking wine at that time. And this you know, may Allah put him in the place that he has to be, he insisted to the Imam, you know, drink. And the Imam said, no. مَا خَامَرَ لَحْمِي وَدَمِي قَطْ. My flesh and blood is never ever mixed with alcohol, with intoxicants. And so he realized that, you know, Imam is strongly refusing this. Then he says, okay, if you don't want to do this, then you have to recite some poetry. And Imam said, I'm not really into poetry. He said, no. You refuse the first one, this one you have to do it. And Imam there actually recited 5-6 lines. And this actually, at least for that moment, even changed the behavior of Mutawakkil as far as drinking is concerned. Let me, you know, briefly, you know, present those verses where he says, باتوا على قلل الأجبال تحرسهم غلب الرجال فما أغنتهم القلل. He says there were people who lived in the summits, guarded by strong guards, but the summits did not help them. When the time of death came, even these people who were protected, they have to die. واستنزلوا من بعد إز من معاقلهم فعودعوا حفرا يا بئس ما نذل. You know, after their glory, staying there in the summits, they were brought down. And when they were brought down, they were put in a hole, the grave. And it is a pitiful place of landing. ناداهم صارخ من بعد ما قبروا أين الأسرة والتيجان والحلل. When they were put in the grave, then somebody called and asked them, where is your family? Where are your crowns? Where are your garments? وَعَيْنَ الْوَجُوهُ الَّتِي كَانَتْ مُنْعَمَةً مِنْ دُونِهَا تُضْرَبُ الْأَسْتَارُ وَالْكِلَلُ. Where are those delightful faces? They were all concerned, you know, with curtains and veils. Of course, those who are dead will not respond. فَعَصْبَحَ الْقَبْرُ عَنْهُمْ هِينَ سَاعَلَهُمْ. The grave now responds to this question, where are they? تِلْكَ الْوُجُوهُ عَلَيْهَا الدُّودُ يُقْتَتَلُ. The grave responds by saying that those faces that you are talking about, they are there in the grave, and the insects are feeding on them. قَدْ طَالُ مَا أَكَلُوا دَحْرًا وَمَا شَرِبُوا. For a long, long time, they ate and they drank. فَأَصْبَحُوا بَعْدَ طُولِ الْعَقْلِ قَدْ أُكِلُوا. And after a long time of eating, now they are being eaten by the insects. And this is where Fabakal Mutawakkil, you know, Mutawakkil started to cry, and he asked his servants to move away the glass of wine and the bottle of wine. I don't know, it was just a temporary thing he did, or this convinced him totally, I don't know about it. And this is where we see that, you know, Imam talks about this issue in another hadith also. He says, always keep the last moments of your life in your mind. Think about it. When you die, what will be your state? Will you be in the good place or the wrong place? Will your body be found in a place of disrepute or a place where you should be there? Will you be found doing things which were haram when your last moment came? Because you don't know. And this is what I say to the young people when they ask me, well, you know, I have friends. They ask me to go for a party. It's in a club. But I'm sure I'll not drink. You know, can I go? This is the question we have to ask. What will happen if Jibreel comes to you there at that time? Is that what you want your last moments to be? You know, this is what we have to think about. Because every human being goes through this pull of desire. And this is the example that look at the Akhirah, what happens after the death. And inshallah, that will be a sufficient, you know, advisor to us to control our own desires. Inna ahsan al-hadith kitabullah al-aziz. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف على عباده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه. ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه. سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة. أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة عما سلف من ذنوبكم. Another statement from the 10th Imam, but before that, a preamble to that about the issue of referring to the experts. You know, these days we see a trend, even among our own people, where they say we don't need the mujtahideen and ulama. We have the internet. Whenever an issue comes up, we'll look into it, do our research, and form our own opinions. Basically, I call them Mullah Google. You know, this is what they are saying. We don't need really. What they don't realize that every field has its own specialization and expertise. Yes, these days, you know, literacy has improved compared to the past. Many people are fairly educated, they know the language, they can study whatever they want. But the issue is that there's nothing wrong about it. To study what you want to do, but the issue is that you cannot form an opinion or make a decision on things that you read if you are not expert in that field. You know, if you have headache, go to the Mullah Google, you know, type that headache, and you will see many, you know, medical schools also, universities, they will give you, you know, some common information about headaches. But there, when you read more about it, you will see, okay, the headache is caused by so many different, you know, elements. So you have a headache, and you see, okay, they are all different causes. What do you do? You have the information that maybe five things can cause a headache. They might even say, okay, for this, this is the medication. For the second one, this is the medication. For the third one, this is the cure for it. But you still will have to go to the doctor because he has the knowledge and the experience to identify which kind of headache you are having. Or he might even send you for some test to find out the cause before you can get the prescription. And this is where we are saying that, you know, do not take your religion that simple. There are some basics issue. You know, you don't need to ask anyone. Some of things are very obvious in Islam. But when it comes to the, you know, details, and especially when it comes to making a decision for yourself or others, this is where you have to see whether you have the quality, you know, the expertise to do that or not. You know, in Canada, for example, look at the pharmacists. You know, people spend their years studying before they are licensed as pharmacists. But you go to any drugstore, and they say, you know, I have this problem. Can you prescribe something? Is a pharmacist in Canada, by law, allowed to do that? Off-the-counter medicines, yeah. But something which is prescribed by the doctor, a pharmacist, maybe he knows medicine sometimes more than the doctor. But he is not allowed to write a prescription. So close to the, you know, both fields are very close to one another. And this is where we realize, okay, you might be Neem Mullah. You know, Neem Mullah means what? Half-backed Mullah. You might know a few things, but that doesn't give you the right to issue fatwa. A fatwa can only be issued by a mujtahid. And a mujtahid who is mujtahid mutlaq. And so this is a very common sensical issue, and you know, sometimes we think, oh, these are all new things created by the ulama. No. During the days of the Imam, from the 5th Imam, 6th Imam, 8th Imam, many others, including the 10th Imam, there would be cases where people will come to them from faraway cities where they don't have access to the Imam easily. They are not in the same city. Or sometimes the Imams would be in confinement from the government. And there the imams will say, so-and-so is a companion of mine who has studied under me in your city. If you have a problem, go and refer to him. He doesn't say you just think about it yourself or open the Quran and find the solution. Imams during their own times, for those who didn't have access to the imams themselves, would ask them to go to those who are more learned than themselves, you know, to seek guidance. There was a person by the name of Hamad al-Razi. He lived in this Tehran and southern Tehran, Shahr-e-Rey area. And he had come to the Imam, and, you know, there were some issues about religious questions. At the end, although the question is not there in the hadith, but it seems he must have asked him that I'm going back home. And if I have religious issues, what do I do? Our 10th Imam says, إِذَا أَشْكَلَ عَلَيْكَ شَيْءٌ مِّنْ عَمْرِ دِينِكَ بِنَاهِيَتِكَ, that if you are ever faced with a problem in the matter of your religion in your area, فَاسْأَلْ عَنْ عَبْدُ الْعَزِيزِ بِنْ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ الْحَسَنِ. Go and ask Abdul Aziz, Abdul Aziz al-Hasani. Those of you going for ziyarat in Iran, you know, in the southern part of Tehran, there is a place of shrine, the shrine of Shah Abdul Aziz. He was one of the companions of the Imam, lived at that time. And he comes from the descendants of the Ahlul Bayt. And a learned person, an Imam is saying to Hamad al-Razi that you are in that area and this person is there. If you have a problem, you can find, cannot find the answer, go to him. He will guide you. And so this is a very commonsensical issue which has been there, you know, according to the ayat of Quran, as well as the seerah of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam. So do... do your research, you know, think about it, ask questions, you know, but don't issue fatwas. You have to realize there is a limitation there. And fatwa can only be issued by a mujtahid who is mujtahid mutlaq. Allahumma salli ala sayyid al-mursaleen wa shafi al-mudhunibin nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Wa ala imam al-muttaqeen wa amir al-mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi alayhi. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد شباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما حيا صار البدوة طغيان هادمي أبنية الشرك والنفاق
حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وسهل مخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.